Levi and Haanel, star people. Welcome to Stop, Drop, and Meditate. My name is Envy McKee, but you knew that because you're on my page. Anyway, so welcome. Today is Friday, so this is the last day of this week's meditation, and congratulations. We are on our eighth week of the Master Key series. Is this the eighth week? Yeah, it is. This is the eighth week. But this is the going into the ninth month of doing this whole daily group virtual meditation. So congratulations. Welcome. If you are new, this is a virtual group meditation, which essentially means that we all come together on our phones and we sit together in meditation, recognizing that energy is non-local. So whatever we do here together, wherever two or more gather, this is considered a virtual gathering. We're amplifying that energy. So that's why we do this together. We learned our practice. We practice our practice and we learn how to meditate together and we amplify our results. So well done. What we do here is the very first thing is we do the neck rolls to get our necks loosened and primed so that we can sit for an extended period of time. Then I read a page from the Master Key system, which is about how to focus your attention, how to have dominion, and I want to say dominion, but it's more than that. It's first of all, it's understanding that you have a subconscious mind, and then it's understanding what to do with it, how to entrain your consciousness, your conscious self, to make use of your subconscious mind. And it sounds more complicated than it is. It's not. And that's why the Master Key system is such a powerful book, because it gives you an understanding of what we're doing here beyond what my explanations are. And then we sit in meditation. Today we're doing this earlier because I wanted to try and see what this group thing would be. We've been doing it in the 9 o'clock hour. We started out doing it at 11:11, then we moved to 10, then we moved to 9. It is the natural progression, I suppose, to move to 8. And I'm sure at some point it'll be at 7. This is natural. I'm just trying it out. I'm trying to see if this is something that I can do and sustain every single day consistently so we can do this together. And I think that's all the insight that you need. We're going to be sitting for a half an hour today. I've been doing the 1 hour sessions, and while I love doing it and it's fine and fun and fabulous, the whole idea is for us to be able to do this as a group. And yeah, we'll leave that there. So get yourself into your comfortable position. I'm just pulling up the Master Key so I can have that on the ready. We're going to do our neck rolls. 63. It's cold. Okay. So you're in your comfortable seat. Just breathe for a moment. Feel your body begin to figure it out. If you let it, your body will come into alignment all by itself. It'll show you what to do. And if you can follow directions. You'll be led. All right, and once you've settled in, take your chin and relax it to your chest. You're stretching out the back of your neck. Excuse me. Nobody stretches out the back of their neck. I don't know why. But we are. And then to the left, you're relaxing your shoulders and you're getting a stretch by using gravity. So you want to keep your shoulders relaxed, no shrugging. And you want to breathe as you allow your head to go in the direction, the left, of the left. So you're stretching out the right side of your neck. And back. To the right. Same thing. Relax your shoulders. Forward. Breathe through it. The more you breathe, the more of a stretch you get. Right? Allow your head to be heavy. Forward. And come back to center. And your neck should feel longer. You should feel taller in your seat because you stretched that muscle. Yes. So just allow yourself to feel that new sensation of tallness. Allow yourself to feel that new sensation of alignment, where you can see a gorgeous silver strand running through your seat. It's running from the earth through your seat, up through your spine, in a straight line out of your head. It normally starts out as a string. You see it, that it's there, and then connects you to everything. But then that string becomes a portal. It's larger, maybe a rope, size of a rope, maybe bigger than that. And you see your connection to Source is wide and flowing, strong and powerful. And I use the word portal, but that's what it's like. A portal is more of an opening, and this is that, and yet it's also a flow of light. So you can visualize yourself having that flow, whatever feels comfortable for you. You can visualize the string. You can visualize the silver rope. You can visualize this flowing portal, like a waterfall, but the size and roundness of your head. And it's pouring through. But it pours down and up at the same time, so it's like a stream. A waterfall, a light waterfall stream, if you can imagine. And so it's with this sense of connection, or finding, searching for connection. And we remember that what we look for, what we are seeking, is also seeking us. That's why they say, ask and the door, ask and it shall be answered, knock and the door shall be opened. Because what you are seeking is also seeking you. So if you're looking for your connection to all that there is, you will find it. If you're looking for your design, you will find it. If you are looking for your purpose, you will find it. If you're looking for your mission, you will find it. Whatever you search for in earnest, with loving intention, you will find. And so right now, we're looking just gently. We're gently looking for our connection. We're gently seeing ourselves connected. We're gently looking for that string, silver string, that rushing portal, whatever it is you visualize. We're looking for it. And it's with that same sense of reverence that now we're going to listen. And I'm going to read a little more. Good morning. I'm going to read a little more of what we read from yesterday and the day before, because this is so powerful. It is so powerful. If I could pick the most important passage in this entire book, it would be the words I'm about to read. Well, these first few paragraphs. And this right here is the nucleus of what we're here to learn. So the first step is idealization. It is likewise the most important step, because it is the plan on which you are going to build. It must be solid. It must be permanent. The architect, when he plans a 30-story building, has every line and detail pictured in advance. The engineer, when she spans a chasm, first ascertains the strength requirements of a million separate parts. They see the end before a single step is taken. So you are to picture in your mind what you want. You are sowing the seed, but before sowing any seed, you want to know what the harvest is to be. This is idealization. If you are not sure, return to the chair daily until the picture becomes plain. It will gradually unfold. First, the general plan will be dim, but it will take shape. The outline will take form, then the details, and you will gradually develop the power by which you will be enabled to formulate plans which will eventually materialize in the objective world. You will come to know what the future holds for you. Then comes the process of visualization. You must see the picture more and more complete, see the detail, and as the details begin to unfold, the ways and means or bringing it into manifestation will develop. One thing will lead to another. Thought will lead to action. Action will develop methods. Methods will develop friends, and friends will bring about circumstances. And finally, the third step, or materialization, will have been accomplished. We all recognize the universe must have been thought into shape before it ever could have become a material fact. And if we are willing to follow along the lines of the great architect of the universe, we shall find our thoughts taking form, just as the universe took concrete form. It is the same mind operating through the individual. There's no difference in kind or quality. The only difference is one of degree. The architect visualizes her building. She sees it as she wishes it to be. Her thought becomes a plastic mold from which the building will eventually emerge, a high one or a low one, a beautiful one or a plain one. Her vision takes form on paper, and eventually the necessary material is utilized and the building stands complete. The inventor visualizes his idea in exactly the same manner. For instance, Nikola Tesla, one of the greatest inventors of all ages, the man who has brought forth the most amazing realities, always visualizes his inventions before attempting to work them out. He did not rush to embody them in form and then spend his time in correcting defects. Having first built up the idea in his imagination, he held it there as a mental picture to be reconstructed and improved by his thought. In this way, he writes in The Electrical Experimenter, I am enabled to rapidly develop and perfect a conception without touching anything. When I've gone so far as to embody in the invention every possible improvement I can think of and see no fault anywhere, I can put into concrete the product of my brain. Invariably, my device works as I conceived it should. In 20 years, there's not been a single exception. If you can conscientiously follow these instructions, you will develop faith. The kind of faith that is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You will develop confidence, the kind of confidence that leads to endurance and courage. You will develop the power of concentration, will enable you to exclude all thoughts except the ones which are associated with your purpose. The law is that thought will manifest in form, and only one who knows how to be the divine thinker of his own thoughts can ever take a master's place and speak with authority. Hear that. The law is that thought will manifest into form, and only one who knows how to be the divine thinker of his or her own thoughts can ever take, can ever take a master's place and speak with authority. Clarity and accuracy are obtained only by repeatedly having the image in mind. Each repeated action renders the image more clear and accurate than the preceding. And in proportion to the clarity and accuracy of the image will the outward manifestation be. You must build it firmly and securely in your mental world, the world within, before it can take form in the world without. And you can build nothing of value, even in the mental world, unless you have the proper material. You can have the material, you can build anything you wish. When you have the material, you can build anything you wish, but make sure of your material. You cannot make broadcloth with shoddy. We're just gonna imagine we know what that means. This material will be brought out by millions of silent mental workers and fashioned into the form of the image which you have in mind. Think of it. You have over 5 million of these mental workers ready and in active use. They are called brain cells, and you have more brain cells than that, but remember, this was written a long time ago. Besides this, there is another reserve force of at least an equal number, ready to be called into action at the slightest need, your power to think. Then, in almost unlimited, the power to think then, comma, is almost unlimited. And this means that your power to create the kind of material which is necessary to build for yourself any kind of environment which you desire is practically unlimited. In addition to these millions of mental workers, you have billions of mental workers in the body, every one of which is endowed with sufficient intelligence to understand and act upon any message or suggestion given. These cells are busy creating and recreating the body. But in addition to this, they are endowed with psychic activity, whereby they can attract to themselves the substance necessary for perfect development. They do this By the same law and in the same manner that every form of life attracts to itself the necessary material for growth. The oak, the rose, the lily, all require certain material for their most perfect expression, and they secure it by silent demand, the law of attraction. The most certain way for you to secure what you require for your most complete development. Hunty. We're getting into the thick of it now. The first chapters, and we'll say so much as to say the first six chapters, the first six.
I rise. Ooh. I shine.
I suit up. I show.
My meditation now has commercials, which is awesome. So the first six parts, they were basically the setup. They were getting you primed. And because we are doing this, we are reading these pages right before we're about to meditate. It's a part of our meditation practice. We actually have the perfect primer because a lot of the things in the first six chapters were really about getting you to meditate, getting you to sit your behind down and understand the physiology, understand why you're meditating, understanding, you know, the power of meditation and what meditation can harness for you. That is your thinking, your thoughts, and having dominion over your whole self. Taking full, as this is how Dr. B describes it, taking full 100% control over your life. And so saying that, now that we're into the seventh chapter, we're starting to actually get into the meat of this. We're actually starting to get some things that we can actually work with, not only in our meditation, but in our lives in general. So these are powerful times. And I want you to be here. And then there's another part of this equation as I have you seated in captive audience. I'm thinking about extending this to YouTube, and I'm trying to figure out how to be able to do both at the same time if possible, or if I'm just going to continue to tape these and then just post them to YouTube. But I want to involve more people in our live expression. So I'm just putting that out there. I think that this group meditation has been powerful for me, and prayerfully it's been powerful for you. So I'd like to extend it to more beings in the world. Okay, so you're in your comfortable seat. You have heard the word, and so now we are going to begin. You've heard the good word. And so take that deep breath. We've entered into sanctuary. We're breathing. We're staying present through watching our breath. We're getting our ease and grace from the rhythm of the in and out. Our breath goes in. Oxygen, carbon dioxide. Oxygen, carbon dioxide. That is a chemical reaction. Chemistry is happening every time you breathe. Biology is happening every time you breathe. Physics is happening every time you breathe. You are a science creation, and thus you are a math equation. The more I do this, the more I learn about myself and us, just from a spiritual perspective, the more connected and attracted to the sciences and math I become. I recognize that God does not speak English. God, whatever we believe God to be, the architect of life, speaks in math, numbers. And so our saying that we don't get math is usually just a fear. Because it's a language. And some of us, not for nothing, are challenged with the language that we're born into. And so today I want, not only as we ponder what we've heard in the Master Key passage today, I want us to ponder the math and the sciences, the fundamental things that we are, and really come into alignment with those things. A willingness, maybe. We've been taught to fear and dislike things that we might not understand right away, or might be complicated to understand, partly because they aren't priorities in our communities, in our schools, in our environments, in our country. But just because they aren't environments in our physical environment does not mean that whatever age we might find ourselves, they can't be of interest to us, that we can't study them, we can't find our alignment with them, and come to understand them as we come to understand other subjects. I feel like if we can begin to learn the sciences, we can begin to understand ourselves and our placement. And if we can merge our art with our science and our spirituality, we will have a more whole picture of who we are and why we're here, and understand the chemical reactions of our presence, understand the physiology of our thoughts, and be able to, as Charles Haanel says in the book, take full 100% dominion over our thoughts, understand the process of the law of attraction, the scientific process, and have an easier time manifesting. And so it is with this sense of wonder that we leave our fears, our doubts, our worries, our ideas of limitation, our fear of the unknown specifically, our stagnation. We leave them at the altar. Pull them out. Or whatever your vision is. Anything that does not serve us and our highest potential, we pull those things out. We toss them in a basket. I've upgraded to basket. And we place them at the altar. So we don't need to carry those things with us to sanctuary. We can leave them at the door. So we can be open and available for the insights. We can see our connection. We can hear the message. So we're not hindered or blocked, constipated, if you will, by stagnant ideas. All things made new. Into the breath. You are safe now, and you are sane. You are awake now, and you are available. You are open now. Where's your attention? Stay here on the breath. Watch your breath. Feel it going in your body and out. See it as your connection to life, this life. And also the connection to your highest self. See all the connections as you breathe. See the chemistry. See the biology. See the algebra. See the physics. See the architect's work with every breath, knowing that you did not create the breath. You did not create the air. You did not create the chemical reaction that makes breathing possible, that makes breathing viable to keep you alive. So relish in that, appreciate that. You are miraculous, a miracle. The dream of life itself. You are an answered prayer. Someone prayed for you, and here you are, breathing. That is no small feat. Humble yourself to that. The gratitude. An intricate being here for an intricate purpose. I fit in this puzzle. I'm designed to be here. Just like everything else is designed to fit perfectly, flawlessly in every way. Breathe into that. And really take the time to take your breath. To see it happening, to be present for it. Take nothing for granted. Particularly, especially not you. requires your attention. Find your way back to the breath. You have your whole day to think about whatever you want. Allow this time really to honor, appreciate, watch, study your foundational systems. Watch this process that's keeping you alive. Pay attention to how you feel as you breathe. What's going on in your fingers, your toes? Really take the time to scan and feel and appreciate you and your body temple. What your body wants, needs to be full and functioning, healthy and whole, light and ageless. to your body. Back to this moment. Back to this slice. Life, time, space. Whatever insights have come through, bless them and allow them to integrate into your awareness. Allow them to be what you walk with. Write them down. We are blessing ourselves. In this moment, we are blessing our lives, our work, our design. We are remembering our divine nature, our extraordinariness. And as we bless ourselves, we extend that blessing to every being that we will come in contact with today. We forward-thinkingly see us smiling at every person we come in contact with. We see us blessing them and seeing them as a blessing no matter what. We look beyond the nuance and the nuisance of our connection sometimes, and we see the divine nature in all of them. We see how connected we are. We see ourselves as one of one, and we recognize that we are always and persistently looking at ourselves everywhere we go. We're looking at our reflection. Even if someone we perceive that someone to be nothing like us, see the paradox. See the truth. We are all one thing. We are all extensions of each other. We are unique emanations of the presence of God. And whatever you believe God to be, unique emanations of the presence of God. Nearer than your breath, closer than your hands and feet. You are waves. We are waves in the ocean. Unique, and yet the ocean itself. One of one, part of the whole. And as that begins to resonate, we extend it further, not only to people we will come in contact with, but the world at large, this world. Both the dying world, the world that seems all mixed up, upside down. The world that seems to be looted and being looted. The world that seems greed. The greedy are doing a smash and grab. That world. Those beings are part of the dying paradigm. They are out. And somewhere fundamental, they know that they're out. It's hard to let go of the world that made you. But we are here to birth a new world. We understand that there's a difference between the world and the planet. The planet is this place that we all live. The world is the coagulation of thought forms. It is held together by our agreements and our conversations about those agreements. The world, that world, the old world, the coagulation of thought forms that created all of these systems that serve a very specific paradigm and a very specific group of people, that world is dying. Closer to dead than we think. Gasping for breath. Yes, that's why the smash and grab is going on. They're trying to hold on for dear life. They are the festering wound. And so we bless them in their journey on the way out. Thank you, we say. Thank you, a resounding thank you for helping me unfold my soul. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your active participation in the unfoldment of my soul. Thank you for being my reflection, helping me to see the ugly parts that I didn't want to see. Thank you. You're doing God's work. God bless you. And then you focus on the work that you're here to do. The birthing, the midwifing, the new world, the new paradigm, the new agreements, the new loving, kindly, generous, coagulated thought forms. The process works the same. Just what will you have? Will you have more of the old dying world, more of that? Or will you actively participate in creating something new? Every time you sit, you come into alignment. Every time you come into alignment, you make a new agreement. Every time you make a new agreement, you, in essence, help craft the new world. What will you have? Detachment, which looks like what we have, or connection? The beloved community, or divide and conquer. It's up to you. Every moment, your choice is how you live your life, how you actively participate in your life, who you are kind to, who you are generous with, who you love, show love to, who you extend your patience for, with, who you wrap your arms around, who you share your bounty with. Every choice, every thought is an agreement. Every idea, every unfoldment, every action that we take is an agreement. We are building the new world, thought by thought, idea by idea, action by action. Meditation by meditation. What world are you creating with your life right now? And what world will you choose to create as you go along this day? And if you are not living up to your highest potential, what actions can you take to do so? What will you have instead of your complaints? Your complaints contribute to the world as well. They are agreements too. And so with this new understanding, we make new agreements. I am seeing it now. Agreements of love, of peace, of joy, of kindness, of generosity. I am seeing it now, embracing our brothers and sisters. Particularly, especially when we don't agree with them, we are loving them up and we refuse to argue about the basics. We love each other up and we extend it. The basics are who we are fundamentally. They are not debatable. And so we are loving up on people's opinions of what the basics should be. And we are recognizing that love is the answer, no matter the question, love. Radical acceptance is the answer, no matter the question. Love, peace, joy, kindness, generosity, radical acceptance. That is the answer to every question. I am seeing it now. It is our new mantra. We have a gorgeous grasp of the basics and we act accordingly in each other's lives. We are blessed and a blessing. We are the dream of life itself and we are acting accordingly. I am seeing it done. I am seeing a transformation. I am seeing a divine unfoldment. As we yet breathe with every breath, our cells are in agreement. We are raising up by force or by foul life, the gorgeous, gorgeous, natural, pure unfoldment of our lives, the gorgeous evolution of our souls. It is a cause set in motion. And so there is a quantum leap happening with all of us. Critical mass happening with all of us. So that all of us don't have to get this on our own. It happens naturally. The kinks are worked out. Quantum leap to our highest potential. The old world falls out. The bottom falls out by the new world is birth. Hello. Gorgeous. Ease and grace. I am seeing ease and grace. I am calling forth ease and grace quietly and sweetly and without incident. We are waking up. We are standing up and we are standing in our power. We know what our power is. We are seeing it done and we are living it fruitfully, fully, exulting in the gorgeousness of the natural design of our lives. That is the word spoken for all of us today. It is the truth. It is God in movement through our lives, through our cells, through our molecules. It's a cause set in motion. And so we bless each other. We thank God and we say thank you for our ancestors, the ascended masters, the angels, and all of those who are helping us, guiding us, speaking the word for us, holding the high watch for us, surrounding us with love as we figure it out and get it together. Now, they've stepped in further, pushing this process along so that we might reach our critical mass. We might match our vibrational quantum leap and be the change necessary for all the changes that are making their way. They are standing in proxy for us. And we are in full gratitude with them. Thank you for your guidance. Thank you for your help. Those in agreement as we end this session, this gorgeous, beautiful unfoldment of our souls. We say, and so it is, and so be it. And we let it be. Amen. Thank you for being here, Star People. See you Monday. Peace and blessings.